Can you feel it? Can you feel it? Can you feel it? Can you feel the crackdown? I certainly can. There is an overall feeling of meltdown. Just intense anxiety and meltdown. The facade that of civilization is about to crumble and fall apart. And we have been fooled as a bluff into thinking that we are so elevated now. That is not true at all. It's like we're sitting on sand, a bluff of sand that just can crumble. And it is crumbling right now. And I'm being very sensitive. I'm aware of it. Very intense situation right now. And I'm also aware that it's now called the time of blessing. We have the time of the crackdown, and then the corollary to that is the time of blessing, where we go beyond words. I understand the situation. I can speak it verbally, but it gets too awkward. It gets too awkward because we need the remedy to the crackdown right now. We don't have time anymore to listen to, you know, words. It's a time factor. So we need an immediate blessing. And the blessing basically tells us it, to use the language of business, which most people are familiar with, it's already been paid for. You know, you don't have to pay for it. It's already been paid for. You know, it's like a gift, in other words, a gift. Who gives this gift? The Holy Spirit gives the gift, has placed within our minds a dream, a perfect dream, a perfect perception, in which there's no loss of identity seen at all, which then frees us from the continuity problem that we have and enables us to set down all perception and dreams altogether, saves us. We're already saved. Everybody's already saved. And we just need to get this feeling of permission to accept this. We live in a sort of a situation of permissions. And we feel bound because we don't feel like we've been given permission from the, you know, whoever it is that we feel we need to get permission from. The blessing is simply comes from that aspect which we feel we need to get permission from. Somehow shows up and says, hey, you've got permission, don't worry, it's already been paid for. You don't have to pay for it. You don't have to pay for it. Meaning, we don't have to be the authors of our own salvation. The Holy Spirit has done it for us. And we need to hear that permission. That's called the blessing. That's called the blessing. So I expect someone to show up in this world, I do, to give us that permission. You're free to go. You don't have to pay for anything. The crackdown that is happening, I was tipped off by it last night in a dream where this authority figure, this policeman, was cracking down and giving people tickets, targeting, profiling certain aspects of society. As you know, the white male Christian is the new Jew of the new Holocaust, as it were, the new program to scapegoat and target. And so there's this severe crackdown is going to take place. And this policeman was doing that and, you know, ticketing this man for very petty reasons, actually. And there's a big argument. And the policeman said, look, this is what's going on. And he leveled with the guy. He said, look, this is what's going on. There's a big crackdown going on, okay? This is what's happening. And if you don't want to be, you know, cracked down on, it's best that you just avoid this area altogether. Okay? I'm telling you, the honest truth, this is what's going on. And this is coming from the policeman who was doing the cracking down. And he was honest. He said, look, he realized that in his heart, he realized that it's not right. But he's got his orders, okay? So he conveyed to this person. There's a white man. He said, look, it's best you avoid this area altogether right now. And I heard that, and I said, wow, yeah. And there were police everywhere throughout this neighborhood. I was going through this neighborhood. You know, motorcycle cops, patrol cars, huge dragnet, you know, is just like, whoa, this is bad news, folks. So the crackdown is coming. And the ego has targeted certain people, certain people. There's this profiling program going on that's developing profiles of everyone here. And there's a profile that if you fit this profile, you're going to be cracked down on, no question about it. Then there was this waitress. I was in a restaurant right near there, just right there where it was happening. And I ordered some orange juice, I was drinking the orange juice. And the waitress said, you don't have to pay for it, don't I? She says, it's already been paid for. You already, you know, somehow. She said, don't worry, you don't have to pay for it. It's on the house, you know. So I didn't feel like I needed to make any sort of payment or anything like that. And so it was like this permission, like, to go. You know, you can go. Don't worry about trying to pay for anything here. And this is the blessing. This is like the permission. You're saying, no, you're free to go. There's no payment. No payment. Forget about that. It's already been paid for. I wasn't quite clear. I was in the dream, but I still said, oh, okay, let me pay for it anyway. Said, no. Don't have to. Don't have to pay for it. The crackdown is coming. And those who are targeted know it. Of course, if you're not targeted at this point, you're not worried about the crackdown. If you are targeted, you certainly are aware of it. Just like the Jews in Germany, they were aware, hey, they're targeting us. Because all the laws that they passed, right? Restrictions and laws, they realize, wow, they're trying to, you know, kneecap us here. And we better get out before it's too late, sort of thing. So there's no question that there's a kneecapping taking place now that is targeting certain, you know, segment of society. That segment of society that is most resistant to the New World Order and the New World Religion and all of this centralized bureaucracy, etc., etc., etc. But there's more to it than that. Way more to it than that, actually. That's just the nice part of it. There's a nasty part to it too, and this is something that people can only dimly sense. It's something I see clearly, but I don't, if I start talking about it, I'll probably get my account pulled on YouTube because, you know, I'll shake the trees, that rock the boat too much. But let's just say the crackdown is coming, and it's starting. So the blessing will also come, which is, the blessing is a permission, is a permission. Probably coming from female sources, because ultimately in society, in the world, there's a fact that only the smart ones really know. There are some smart, very smart women in the world who know this truth, is women run the world, they run the universe, the feminine component runs the universe. All wars are fought between women. Men are simply the foot soldiers that fight the females' wars for them. And this is a fact. And so the thing, if you hear a woman giving you permission, say, no, you can leave. No, you don't need to pay. In other words, you don't need to fight. You don't need to fight for me. Forget it. No. That's the permission that men need, because men feel they cannot leave the situation unless they get permission from women, because really women have been always running the show, always. Sometimes in the background, sometimes in the foreground. But they decide what fights they want to fight. The fights are between women. They're not between men at all. Again, men are just the soldiers who are given the orders. Say, okay, you need to go over there and you need to fight them, because, you know, the squabbles are really between women. Men don't want to fight, actually. They don't want to kill each other. They don't want to do this. You know, it's up to men. They would be playing chess or something. So the permission actually needs to come from the feminine component to tell us, hey, you don't need to stay here. You don't need to fight any wars. You don't need to do any fighting. You're free to go. You don't need any payment. And getting that permission, then the men will say, wow, okay. But without that, I find that it's virtually impossible. And, you know, again, there are wise women in the world who know this is true. It's just that if they say this, they will be set upon by, you know, the armies of other women. They don't like this. There's kind of a sisterhoodness. That, you know, it's a sorority. We don't dare tell our secrets to anybody. If you do, you're going to be really cracked down on yourself, you know. So they don't say it, but they know it. They don't say it. Some haven't tried in the past, and they got cracked down on very hard. Very, 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 very hard. No question about it. But I know you're out there who understand this and are tired of fighting these battles, you know, tired of using men to fight wars, tired of these squabbles, tired of these wars. And you say, I just want to accept the blessing of the Holy Spirit. I want to see this perfect perception. That's all, this dream that makes all other dreams unnecessary. This dream of time which trumps all dreams of time. That is what the Holy Spirit has. It's still a dream of time, but it trumps all other dreams of time. And then that frees you from, it solves the continuity problem. So you're not afraid of disorientation and dropping perception. You realize disorientation comes entirely from the ego insisting its secret remedy is to embrace mutual exclusives at the same time. And that leads to this total mental chaos, disorientation. Again, I have experienced that directly. I know what I'm talking about here. Without any question, this is the ego's plan. It's its ace up its sleeve. This is what it's really leading you to. And when you're unable to do this, which no mind can do this, embrace mutual exclusives, it blames you and says you're incompetent. It says you're totally incompetent. And you're wicked, you're terrible, you're worthless, you're stupid, you're eternally incompetent, you know, because you can't carry out the advice the ego is giving you. So in other words, you the ego can't be seen as God because you can't, its advice doesn't work for you. So the ego's furious and blames you that you're going to be damned forever because you cannot accept God. You cannot do what God is asking you to do. No, it's the ego that is asking you to embrace mutual exclusives. Embrace both truth and lies, like both of them are true. And you're supposed to be able to accept this. You cannot. That's saying light and darkness are both light. You know, mutual exclusives are, like for instance, yeah, spirit can suffer annihilation, and yet it cannot suffer annihilation. It's supposed to be embrace both of those in your mind. It's impossible. You will suffer this feeling of eternal chaos. Horrible. The worst experience possible. I've had it. And never want to have it again. And yet the ego is insisting that I go back to that experience. You know, so of course I'm feeling very nervous about this crackdown now. The reason for these rallies, etc., is to generate the resolve to carry out this crackdown. The rally yesterday in Washington, it's to get the resolve to carry out this crackdown. You know, just like the Nuremberg rallies and things like that. It's to get the resolve, you know. I mean, the German people got this resolve. They thought they're going to carry out this crackdown. All right, America, same thing. And we've been led to the same sort of thing. It's just the target is a little different this time. But the resolve to carry out this crackdown is what I feel the tipping point has been reached now. That's why I'm suddenly have this panic attack of nervousness. The resolve has been reached to carry out this crackdown. And therefore, but the good side of it is that we get the blessing now. We get the blessing means the permission to sidestep it. And we need the permission. Because there are not many women in the world who want to lose their armies, you know, their warriors that are fighting for them, fighting to get what they want. You know, go out there and fight for it, you know, get me what I want. There's not many. And those that are, they're feeling jittery about it, you know. Who wants to lose their army? You know, and a lot of men are saying, hey, we don't want to fight for you anymore. We don't want to be your heroes or warriors anymore. And what's happened is that the females of the world have just said, okay, you're history, you're toast, and we're going to find some hero warriors that will do what we want them to do. And that's what happens. That's why a lot of women have turned to the reptilians, actually. Reptilians are a ferocious warrior race, and they just say, oh my gosh, look at these heroes, look at these vicious fighters who can get me what I want, who can vindicate my desires and all this. And so they go that way. They go to other races, more warlike races, you know. They're willing to get into bed with anyone who is going to be their warriors, foot soldiers for them, and fight for what they, for their desires. And that's what they've done. That is what they have done, actually. And I think that a lot of men are realizing, uh-oh, you know, we've been abandoned. We've been abandoned. But there is this blessing that comes into the world where there's some feminine permission given to everyone, but to these men too. You don't have to. You don't have to fight for me. You don't have to pay any price. You're already safe. You got my permission to go to a place of refuge, go to a place of safety. You don't have to fight. Okay. You don't have to pay any price. You get this permission. The blessing is a permission. And then we say, oh, wow. You mean we're not completely abandoned? Say, no. Holy Spirit hasn't abandoned you. So the facade of civilization that we have now is about to collapse in a hurry, like a big sinkhole, actually. It's been undermined, like sand. Its sinkholes are suddenly appearing, right? Big sinkholes. Yeah, that's symptomatic of what's happening on a greater level of society, is these sinkholes will suddenly feel just like, oh, going into the severe depression, feeling that we don't have any permission, feeling that we can't do anything. So what we're praying for is this blessing, which is, again, permission, giving permission. Greatest being I've ever come across, that I ever on this planet, is for me, is Ananda Mahima. And this was a female who wanted absolutely nothing from us. Didn't want anything from us except for us to accept our salvation. That's it. And that's why the feeling I got, I realized, wow, she doesn't want anything from me. She doesn't want me to be a soldier for her, to fight for her, to try to get something for it. Nothing. So just accept your salvation. You're free. You're already saved. Accept this fact within you. You know, getting that, I got this sense of permission, you know. So I've been able to withstand this onslaught now of guilt. The thing is that the females want to use the men to get what they, their desires, what they desire. And they can't stand the thought of men not fighting for them. It so enrages them that this might be some men who disobey their orders, that they want those men killed. They don't want them around. It's an affront to their authority. And so if you just said, no, I'm not going to fight for you, I'm not going to fight to get what you, your desires, etc., that's enough, I want salvation. They want you dead. That is a fact. They want you dead. And so men are like feeling like, wow, we're really in the crosshairs, actually. But along comes this permission from a female saying, no, I don't want you dead. I want you alive. I want you saved. I want you safe. You don't have to fight for me, for anything, because I don't have any fleshly desires at all. Okay? Then we say, hey, we don't have to die. You know, we don't have to die. No, we don't have to die just to satisfy the authoritarian desires of the females who can't stand the fact that there might be some men who won't fight for them. So I've always been persona non grata towards those more militant females, you know, who say, ah, he won't fight for me. He's terrible. Hate him. Get out of here. Get out. I don't want to see your face. You're not willing to, you know, get me what I want. I say, well, what you really want is salvation. So I am telling you about that. They are trapped in the ego's denial structures, not realizing where that leads to, projecting that dead end of the ego onto the Holy Spirit and thinking it's the Holy Spirit that has the dead end. So they've got it upside down and backwards, and you know, it's quite a task to get through those defenses, actually. So when you realize that you have permission to sidestep a thing, then you realize, I don't have to die. I don't deserve to be killed because I won't fight to satisfy someone's vanity and desires. And you know, the truth is that most men know this fact. If you talk with them and they're honest, in the moment of honesty, they'll say, yeah, I know that. Yeah, I know all this stuff. But they can't say it. You know, they don't want to admit that they're so lowly, that they're just slaves here. Remember, in the goddess culture that went on for millennia, long, long, long time, men were just these utter pawns, slaves to the feminine pagan culture, only carrying out the wishes of the priestesses and the goddesses and the feminine matriarchy. And that's the same. And then the gradually a sense that, hey, maybe we don't have to do this, came into being. We had the Old Testament sort of thing, like saying, hey, wait a minute, maybe there's a better way. And then finally we had the New Testament, where Jesus says, look, the Holy Spirit has solved the continuity problem for you, for everyone, you're free. And it's like, oh my God, that's great, unbelievably great message. But now the ego's demanding that we go back into this dreadful matriarchy where men are nothing but the playthings, the boy toys of the feminine matriarchy, to carry out the wars and of battle and acquisition and war and killing and everything. Kill the enemies. Women says, these people are my enemies. They won't do what I want them to do. Kill them. Kill them all. Get rid of them. And men are expected to carry out those orders as if it was they who wanted to do it, you know. But they don't. They don't. They don't. Guaranteed that any man, you really talk to him and they say, hey, you know, let's be friends, you know, I don't want to kill you, I don't want you to kill me, let's be friends. And then the female steps in and says, what are you talking about? And they're so scared that they're willing to kill you to avoid the wrath of the female. So that's a fact in this world. And remember that none of us are male or female at all. We're spirit, and we're trying to train ourselves how to die. And this training program takes on the male-female aspects of it, okay? That is simply a training program. Male and female have zero to do with what we are. Absolutely zero. Okay? It is 100% a training program. But it's a vicious training program. A very vicious training program. And I have completely vetted it and know what it's about and the leverage the ego has is this fear of eternal disorientation. And it's and the ego's secret. See, the ego has this arrogant, smug secret that intrigues everyone. And so here's the problem. We're not quite willing to give up on the ego because we say, what has the ego got, you know, on God? That's our problem, okay? If we want to boil it down right now, we need to boil it down. Where we wonder, what does the ego have on God? The ego's got something. And we're intrigued by it. And we want to find out, what is it that the ego has? Because the ego's so confident, so arrogant. And saying, yeah, I got something. I got the answer, believe me. And we say, what is it? This is bizarre. Well, okay, the only difference between me and anybody else out there is that I found out what the ego's secret is. Okay, I know what it is, beyond any doubt whatsoever. So that's a big difference between people. If you know, the intrigue is gone, and you're not tempted by this intrigue. What pulls people continually on into this training program is the intrigue of what does the ego have on God? What is it? There's some secret. I don't know what it is. I know what it is, so I'm sharing that with you. And at some point, this is going to help you. It, again, it is the ego advising us that we are capable of entertaining mutual exclusives. This is a lie, okay? Because the ego didn't create us. So how does the ego know what we're capable of? God created us. God created the mind, the spirit. And we are not capable of entertaining mutual exclusives. This gives us a sense of total mental chaos, okay? And we cannot call that home. It's impossible. And so the ego then insists that we are wicked, evil, incompetent, and are refusing to carry out its advice for us, that it would work, but we're incompetent, and therefore we need to be annihilated. That's the ego secret. The intrigue that pulls us, keeps pulling us along in this dreadful training program, male, female, different races, all this crazy stuff that can be, everybody's gonna be each other's throats. We're intrigued. What does the ego have on God? We were wondering, what is it? It's as simple as this. The ego thinks that we were capable of entertaining mutual exclusives and making that our home, our new foundation for the new reality. And it is impossible. It is impossible. And you may not, you know, the difference between me and others here is that I experienced this directly. And I know for a fact it's impossible. Whereas others, it may be just conceptual. They say, oh, it's impossible. Why is it impossible? You know, I actually experienced it. I know it's impossible. That's why I'm so adamant about this and telling you the ego is only leading you into a dead end. Because this is its ultimate solution. The final solution of the ego is to entertain mutual exclusives in your mind. Equally, you know, to embrace them both equally as one, mutual exclusives. The ego says, sure, you can embrace reality, but you can also embrace unreality, the denial of reality, both simultaneously. That's the ego's advice to you. That's its secret. That is its secret. It doesn't have any other secrets. That is its secret. Once you discover this, you know for a fact that you're going to get free of all this. Once I went through that experience, I knew, and then I became aware of the Holy Spirit who reassured me that I'm not stupid, I'm not incompetent, etc. It's the ego that is. Once that happened, I knew I was going to be saved, period. It was just a matter of time of finally accepting this fact, coming to acceptance. But I knew, just like that, I knew, yeah, this is the ego's big secret. This is what it's been hiding from us all this time. It's jewel, it's crown jewel, and it finally divulges to me. Says, "Yeah, this is what you got to do." And when you do that, there'll be a new creation, a new reality, and you'll be the prime creator, a new prime creator. And I said, "Ego, it's impossible. The mind can't do it. Cannot make this the foundation. Cannot make eternal chaos and disorientation the foundation of a new creation. It's not possible." And this is not what I want. And then the ego went just completely furious, like God scorned or something. It says, you aren't obeying me, you're incompetent, you're stupid, you're worthless, you don't know anything. You know, you'll never do anything, you're a complete failure. You know, and just heaping this scorn upon me, you know, just, and I said, whoa, you know, I don't think you're right about that, I don't think I'm that worthless. Because I said, I figured this one out, that this is impossible, so I can't be completely stupid. And the ego then is just like freaked out and you know, went away in a big huff, abandoned me. And then the Holy Spirit was there to say, hey, I'm not abandoning you. He says, this is, you've seen what you need to see. So this, again, all the troubles that are coming is based on this sense of intrigue that you have. If you didn't have this sense of intrigue, you would drop all of this and you would easily be saved. Easily. But this intrigue is there. Now, fortunately for me, there was A Course in Miracles had come into the world. And after I had this experience, I came across A Course in Miracles. Or it may have been kind of simultaneously, actually. Yeah, it's possible. It was simultaneous, or I came across A Course in Miracles, and then I had these experiences. That's probably how it went. I'm thinking, so in other words, I must have known that I had a safety net or something, and so I went into it. Because A Course in Miracles explains this very, very well. in getting this explanation, I realized, hey, I'm not crazy. That this is, I understand the situation, what happened. So when you hear this, what I'm sharing here, at least in the back of your mind, you'll say, okay, this is known about. You're not alone. It's known about. This is your desire to follow the ego's advice to find out what's its secret of secrets will pull you into this. And then when you go through this experience, you go, oh my gosh, you know, that's terrible. The ego is a complete deceiver and liar. And you know, what do I do? What do I do? Oh, then you realize the Holy Spirit has solved the continuity issue for us. It's already in our minds. And it's just a matter of turning to that. So if you ask, why don't people just sidestep this whole thing? It's because of the intrigue. It's because of the intrigue. And the intrigue is, I was going home on the freeway yesterday and there's this car pulled in front of me and the name of the car was Intrigue. And so I said, huh, that's interesting. So I get off the freeway, I make a turn on this road, I make a turn on this road, I make a turn on this road, and I'm driving along. And suddenly I realize the same doggone car was right in front of me, Intrigue. I said, oh, okay. So you see, intrigue goes ahead of us and we keep following it. And we're so intrigued about what the ego, the secret the ego has, why it believes it can overcome God, that we don't see all this stuff coming down on us, this crackdown coming. And we don't even, not, you know, say, ah, that's the price I got to pay, you know, to find out the answer. Ah, I see. That's why the waitress told me you've already paid the price. Back then, she goes, back then, meaning previously, I've already seen what the ego's secret is. I see. Whew. Wow. That's it. Yeah, I've already seen it, so I don't have to pay the price. But those who haven't seen it yet will inevitably follow that intrigue, because the intrigue goes in front of them and they keep following and they say, you know, I just want to find out. Because they're thinking, maybe there is a way to have power over God. And when you find out it's this demand that you entertain mutual exclusives, that's the ego's secret. You say, are you kidding me? That's impossible. And they say, oh, man, you know, forget it. What a scam existence is. What a scam this training program is. It's a total scam. But I would say, inevitably, you're going to follow that intrigue. Unfortunately, but honestly, you know, I don't know how you can not want to find out. I mean, we want to find out about this. However, you can rebound from it quickly. That's my desire, to help people rebound from that very quickly, very quickly. You know, there's a support system in place. There needs to be a support system in place to rebound from that. But it's a powerful motivator, this intrigue. We want to find out. So I just want everyone to know that I know exactly what the ego's secret is. There's no intrigue at all for me in existence. No intrigue. No mystery, no intrigue. That's why I make the choices I do, say the things that I do, etc. You know, you know, it's like I'm saying stuff. People say, oh my gosh, the ego must hate you. It's never going to share its secret with you. I already know what the ego's secret is. It already shared it with me, most unfortunately. So I'm not worried about that. I'm not worried about the ego not sharing its secret with me, that kind of thing. So I can say this stuff that seems so audacious without concern, you know. Whereas I know other people are saying, whoa, I better not get the ego too mad at me. It's not going to share its secret with me. So there is that dynamic, but just so you know that there are those who already know. And I got help from those who already knew. Once I had done this, I got the help, heavyweight help, from the Holy Spirit, from Jesus, from Ananda Maima, from Raman Maharshi. I got help from them because they knew that I knew the ego secret, you know? And it's terrible, you know. And So they just said, okay, you know, you're now on the rebound. You're on the rebound and you're on your way to salvation. Absolutely. So the whole situation is a tough one to handicap because of this issue of intrigue. This is the issue. And even though you know that what you're doing is wrong, like Saint Paul, what did he say? He said, you know, I even though I know it's wrong, I keep doing the wrong thing. I keep acting the wrong way, you know, even though I know it's wrong. This is the problem. You know you're in harm's way, you know you're in trouble, you know you're endangered, you know you're, you know, but you're still intrigued about what's the ego's secret. You want to find out. And the ego tells you, well, those other ones, they failed because they were incompetent. But you, you're going to succeed because you're greater than they are. That's the lie, the flattery the ego gives you. He says, yeah, Jesus, he failed, all of their failures, but you're going to succeed. You're going to be the new God because you're going to be able to do, I'll give you the secret, and you are greater than they are. And so you think, oh, wow, that's very intriguing, really. So the ego flatters you, you know, your desire to be prime creator. And then you find out that it's what it demands of you is its advice is entertain mutual exclusives. And you suffer this terrible disorientation, mental chaos. And it's like, oh my gosh, this is, you know, the worst experience possible. It is. It is the worst experience possible. Something you never want to experience twice. Fortunately, you don't have to. Of course, the ego insists that you do. Until you get it. He wants you to keep experiencing it until you get it right. It's impossible. You can never get it right. So you find out, no, you cannot be greater than Jesus. You cannot be greater than anyone because, you know, they couldn't do it and you can't do it and nobody can do it. Nobody can entertain mutual exclusives. Nobody can make both truth and lies true. Okay? It's impossible. Nobody, you can't have God and destroy God too, okay? You can't have reality and destroy it too. You cannot. All you get is mental chaos. So, I would say that those who've watched these videos, at least you got a sense that somebody in your time, in your era, in your situation, has made it through and knows what it's all about, and didn't succeed at the mutual exclusive thing. Have failed like everybody else will fail, and you will fail too at that. And that's okay, it's not a problem at all. Of course you cannot accomplish the impossible. And when the ego tells you you're incompetent, the ego's a liar. And of course we told the mind to lie to us and tell us we could do it. So of course the ego's a liar. So you too will be saved. You also will rebound from it. Once the intrigue's over, it's over. Once it's over for the ego, it is over. The only question is how quickly will you rebound? And there are those who most definitely will support that effort simply because they've done it too. They've been through it too, so they know what it's about. So hopefully you all can get through this quickly. But the support is there. The support is there. It's just behind the scenes. It's subtle. But most definitely, I would recommend getting through this thing. Find out about the intrigue. And don't fight. Don't fight. Don't fight one another. Okay, Jesus said, turn the other cheek. Do not fight one another. Because that is just an exploitation of your intrigue. You're being exploited. It's better to look at what the ego is, what's its secret, and find out and then get on the path of salvation. It's better to do that than to engage in these wars of acquisition and power and control. but you're all entirely egoic again. You know, it's just basically all that stuff. It's just the ego telling you, you have to lay the foundation for the new creation by entertaining mutual exclusives. It's your responsibility. That's what the ego's telling everybody. And of course, everybody is trying to get somebody else to do that. Okay, so all these wars and battles are saying, no, you have to do that. I don't want to do it. You do it. So I said, okay, I'll do it. And then I found out it's undoable. You see, it's funny, because the ones who end up getting saved are really like the ultimate heroes who said, okay, I'll do it. And then they find out it can't be done. And then they turn, instead of heroes, they turn into saints. So that's why usually the ones that are saints are men, because men are the ones who get pressured into doing the dirty work, as a matter of fact, in this world. You know, they build the bridges, they fight the wars, they dig the coal out of the ground, you know, they pick up the garbage, they pave the streets, you know, to do the dirty work. And, you know, the dirtiest work of all is to entertain these mutual exclusives. So, you know, there's what happens is you feel a sense of duty. And for me, I felt, you know what, okay, I'll do it. I'll step up and I'll do it, because I'm getting so much, you know, pressure. And the women say, please be our hero. Please be our hero. You know, please do this for us. I say, okay, I'll do it. And then I found out it's undoable. And then I became like the anti-hero. And failure. You failed, you know. No, I didn't fail. I found out it's impossible, which is the ultimate success. So that puts you on the path to sainthood, to salvation, to liberation. A saint is just someone who's accepted the Holy Spirit's perception, the dream that frees us from all dreams, that's all. They've just found out that the ego's demand, you know, is impossible to fulfill. So they can never be a hero to the world. It's impossible. Nobody can. But those who want to make this world their permanent home, because of the fear of the continuity problem or ignorant of the Holy Spirit, they keep demanding, you know, they keep wanting to acquire more power, more power, more power. So there's fighting. They want a more beautiful realm. They want all these slaves working on their plantations. And they don't want to do the dirty work of entertaining mutual exclusives. They want you to do it. They want you to do it. But you can't win. I mean, if you fight against that and say, no, you do it. No, you do it. It's a constant, no, you do it. It's better to realize that nobody can do it. See, that's the realization that you get. When you try to do it, you find out no one's ever going to be able to do it. So all this fighting and conflict is just ridiculous. That's my perspective on the world. It's totally ridiculous. We're all fighting and jostling to find out who's going to do the dirty work. The dirty work cannot be done. So it's all a waste of time. It's a waste of time. Total waste of time. And society can be ordered in a certain way if there's enough realizers of this truth in the society, and the society is structured around this realization. Then everyone in society, men and women, can begin this realization, begins to seep into all of them, and they become less warlike, less demanding, you know, of conflict and acquisition and power struggles and all this stuff. It becomes less that way. And everybody benefits from it. And they begin to think, hey, you know, this the secret the ego has, it's to accomplish the impossible. And all the fabric of the ego's demands begins to loosen up. But right now it's the opposite. It's the opposite. So there's all these power struggles to try and determine who's going to do the dirty work, the dirtiest of the dirty work. And I tell you, I've already done it, and I found out that it's undoable. Okay? It's undoable. And that's the secret. And so the permission that I got from this waitress, she said, hey, you've already paid. You've already paid. You don't need to pay again. I was willing to pay again. It was stupid. You know, that's just stupidity. I need to have it reinforced. I said, no. You've already paid. And paying again is not going to help anybody. Paying again is not going to help anyone else. You know, I do it again to help others, you know, but no, not really. Because it's so terrible, you really wouldn't do it again. I can say that, but no, honestly, once you have that experience, it's experience that you, even if you could save everybody in the world, you wouldn't do it again. You would not do it again. No way. So it's futile to have such pretensions that, yeah, I do it again. It's not true. It's not true. I'd like to think it, you know, but it's not true. It's not true. No way. No way. It's a one-time thing. And then you realize, geez, all these people in the world, what they're demanding of me is that I do it again. And the whole world is demanding of, if you really want to do the right thing, if you want to do the right thing, this is what you have to do. See, that's my problem. I wanted to do the right thing for the world. I wanted to help the world. The world says, this is what you need to do if you really want to help us. And so I tried. So if you really want to do the right thing, the world, this is what the world will demand of you. And I know it's impossible. And you only want to experience that one time, never again. So no way am I going to go through that again. So in the world's eyes, you know, I'm nothing. I always will be a nothing to the world, a nothing to the world. But not everybody wants the world. You see, not everybody wants the world. So, the blessing should be on its way. The blessing should be on its way. And we will see how this sharing, outpouring comes about. Maybe just as a blessing to people. I feel that what people really need at this time is to simply go somewhere in silence. Just sit in silence and just feel this blessing and say, hey, you know what? It's okay. You don't need to be a hero. You can't be a hero. And that's okay. You can't be a hero. That's a hero to the world. That's okay. You can't be a hero to the ego, and that's okay. It's impossible. You can't, you know, turn the ego into God. You cannot. It's just this unspoken sense of permission, you know. It's okay. It's permission to lay down your arms. Stop trying to fight battles for others, and you accept your own salvation. That's okay. It's just a permission. It's a permission issue, actually. And that will like lighten the load of people, even though they will still follow their intrigue. It will give them a safety net. See, I'm not saying that people will stop following their intrigue. I don't think that's possible. In all these videos I've made, I realize people are still following their intrigue. Okay, but you may decide that you want to decisively see if it's possible. You know, what is the intrigue? Rather than fight to make somebody else do it. Okay? Because if you pick up arms and you're part of this fight that's going to happen in the world, what you're saying is you want to win to force somebody else to do the dirty work, you know. And my position's always been, hey, if there's any dirty work to be done, I'll do it. You know, I'll pick up the garbage. I'll dig the hole. I'll, you know, just look at the jobs I've had in my life, the dirty work. So I was, you know, willing to say, hey, if there's some job that's too tough, you know, for someone else, I'll do it. So be that person. Say, okay, let me find out what it is that the ego is saying will save everyone. And then do that and then rebound from it and realize, ah, okay, I remember something about this. I heard something about this, yeah. You don't have to play the role of the hero. You can find out that there is no such role. You can't play a role that doesn't exist. And so I believe there are a lot of people in the world in this boat, actually, that they're tired of trying to be the hero. They want to find out once and for all what's going on. They don't really want to fight. But they're being pushed into a corner, and they're being told they have to fight. And they said, you know, is there not any alternative to this? And if they can, you know, feel this blessing, then deep down they'll say, you know what? There is an alternative. There is an alternative. And I want to get to that alternative. I still want to, you know, resolve this intrigue, but I want to get to this alternative too. So let me do that. And this experience of a total mental chaos only lasted like an instant, like that. It was over. I saw it and I said, phew, jump back. You cannot do it. And then at that point, I said, wow, that's it. I hit rock bottom and I bounced off of it. And I realized there's something there that's got confidence that I can, you know, that I'm not totally incompetent. And then you're on the spiritual path to salvation. You're essentially saved at that point, actually. Because you realize the ego secret, and it's nothing. And so it's over. It's just then, it's only a matter of time from that point on. So really, it's worth it to do that. It's worth it to pay that price. That's why the waitress told me, you already paid the price. Price was paid back then, meaning, you know, 35 years ago or something. She said, you don't need to pay it twice. That's why I tried to give her $2 twice. She said, no, you don't need to do it twice. Just once. So realize you only need to do it once. And others have done it. You can do it, others done it. Guaranteed you can do it. So don't think you have to get thrown back into that old roles of fighting the fights, you know, being the foot soldiers, or in demanding that others fight for you. You know, the men are the foot soldiers, and women are demand that the fighting take place. So if you're a woman, you realize you don't have to keep demanding that men, you know, do this fight, do the dirty work. You can see for yourself what the ego's secret is, and then be free. And men, you realize, I don't have to keep doing this fight. I can take a look at the ego and see what it is. So both men and women can look and see what the ego's secret is, recognize it's impossible, and at that point realize that they are essentially saved. They are saved. I mean, it's over for the ego. And then the spiritual grace begins to be showered upon one continuously, as you come to an acceptance of all this. And that takes time. That takes some time for sure. But it can be quickened. Because then you say, wow, this is way better than being trapped in this, you know, horrible dynamic of demanding someone else do my dirty work and then feeling that you have to do the dirty work, and you know, this horrible dynamic of existence. You realize you're free of it. You're free of it. So yeah, I was told you don't have to pay twice, and I was willing. I said, here, I'll pay twice. Wait, no. You've already paid. So that's the blessing. The blessing is the one that says you don't have to pay twice. No way. And keeps insisting on that, because for me, being a gallant hero type, I say I'll pay twice, but it's not true. Those are only words, you know. And the blessing, the way it just reminded me, no. You know, you don't really want to pay twice, believe me, right? Forget it. It's not true. It's okay. You don't have to pay twice. And you just get reassured you don't have to be the hero twice. So there we are. We're here right now. The time of the crackdown. The time of the blessing. And it's all on the table. And now you have all this stuff, you know, this filtering in. And you're saying, ha. I'm not quite as boxed in as I thought I was. You know, wow, there really is a way. I can see it, but I'm still intrigued. So just say that. I see it, but I'm still intrigued. You know, okay, let me accept the fact that I'm still intrigued. Let me accept it. Okay, I'm still intrigued. You know, still okay. But at least I kind of know what my intrigue's about. And I realize, hey, you know, there's some way to resolve all this and get free of it all. And I'm not quite sure how to manage it, and yet it I realize it can be managed some way. So there's that new breeze, you know, in the world here that makes a difference in some way. I can't say exactly how it will make a difference, actually. You'll have some kind of wisdom at the right time, which will enable you to avoid the worst of it, so to speak. I'm not saying you won't be caught up in troubles, but you will avoid the worst of it. Somehow, you will make some decision like, wait a minute. I don't have to go, you know, all in on this way. No, I don't have to do that. I don't have to do that. So you will navigate your way into a more fortuitous sort of situation. I'm not saying, again, that people are not going to run into problems. Most definitely, they will. And nobody, you know, as long as that intrigue is there, you find the intrigue, nobody can save you from the problems. Because you're willing to pay the price to find out the answer to this intrigue, the egoic intrigue. And so you're just willing to pay the price. That's all. And you know, but as you become less willing to pay the price, then, you know, you start sidestepping stuff. So we will see what's next. Could be the blessing. Could be a blessing. Could be a blessing. There's two types of female powerhouses that can arise in the world. One is the one who gives the blessing that you don't have to. You've already paid the price. You don't have to pay the price again. Not for me. No way. You've done it. That's enough. You're free. You don't need to do anything more. There's that. And then there's the female who wants to be the figurehead of the new world religion and wants you to worship her. And she says she's going to make all one big happy family in sectarianism and establish just a one world, non-sectarian, religious, universal teaching and lead everybody into the golden age. And it's that female also will come into the world who claims to be the goddess, greater than God. Of course, she says she's serving God, but she actually believes that she is God, and she has the capability to bring peace to the world, and yet leave the intrigue of the ego completely unresolved, leave all this completely unresolved, not have you turn to the Holy Spirit's perfect dream, none of that, just worship her as the great mother. And that's, she says, well, everybody can agree that she's so wonderful, and that will end all sectarianism, etc. This is a pie in the sky, egoic, magical solution to the situation. It doesn't work. But that powerhouse goddess will, I believe, also in the world as we speak, and is trying to recruit people to, you know, trying to recruit me to produce beautiful music and worship of her, to create a figurehead, a feminine matriarchal figurehead around which all nations can agree, look, hey, we all love this figurehead, so let us all get along with one another, and let us create this one religion that has this figurehead as its ideal and all this kind of stuff. That is in play also. So there's that, the great, grandiose goddess, mother, patriarch, mother matriarchal figure to unite all nations and all sectarianism and get rid of all these fights and have golden age of peace, which is all absolute nonsense. And the humble, simple waitress, no position at all in this world, just say, hey, you've already paid your price, you don't need to pay again, that's it, and just giving you permission, you don't have to be the hero for me, you've already paid, you've done what you needed to do, you found out it's impossible, I accept that, I accept it, I believe you, I know you're right that it's impossible. So don't have to do it again for me. No way. Okay? That is the real, you know, liberator. That's the real blessing. That's the real mother. The good mother, as it were. But it's not even a mother. It's not a mother figure. It's a truth figure. It's a permission figure. It's a liberator. It's a savior figure. It's a blessing figure. It's the one that gives us permission. No. You don't have to do it again. No way. I know you've already done it. You're free to go. Don't don't need to pay me anything. That is the great one, not this other one, who is, remember, keep in mind that Ananda Maima, who was this blessing figure, blessing role, absolutely, says you don't have to do it for me. She was offered the position of the figurehead of the New World Religion. So this whole New World Order thing has been going on for a long time, the blueprints and plans, and they picked her and said, you are the one that can do this. And they used Mahatma Gandhi to try and convince her to be this figurehead for the New World Religion. There's a lot of pressure was brought to bear on her from high up. And she completely rejected it. She said, sorry, I can't do that for you. Sorry to let you down, but it's not, I do what God asked me to do, and God is not asking me to do that. And so she flat out turned him down, and many efforts were made, and inducements, etc. She said, no, God has not asked me to do that. And that's the end of it. So that one who's been tested, he realized, wow, there is this capability, you know, in the world for someone to actually do what God asks them to do instead of what the ego asks them to do, no matter what the inducement is, no matter what. Imagine the inducement. The world is willing to place a matriarchal figure and view them as greater than God and worship them and bring all nations under dominion, called the Whore of Babylon, as it were, to worship her. Almost everyone in the world is willing to do that. And yet this figure said, no, not the slightest bit of that. I got no interest in that, no desire whatsoever. I only do what God asked me to do, and God has not asked me to do that at all. So it's not going to happen. Turned it down completely. That's your ally. That's your ally. That's the one that is on your side. That's the ally, you see. It's not going to demand that you keep trying to play the hero. Once you discover you can't, that's it. Don't need to try it. Don't need to do it again. No way. That's the liberator. That's the truth teller. That's the savior. That's the one who gives the blessing and the permission. Very helpful. So you can have these two dynamics at play. No question about it right now. Is the New World Order, his plan is to institute a New World Religion. Get rid of all the sectarian violence, you know, and all the stuff that's so deplorable in the world that they, you know, are tearing their hair out about. And they feel that this is a road to eternal peace. It's not. It's not. It's not. It's a castle. It's a sand castle. And most people don't understand that. I do. I do understand it. It leaves the underlying problem totally untouched. It says we can make this world our permanent home. We can make impermanence our permanent home. The Holy Spirit's not saying that. The Holy Spirit gives us a perfect dream so that we can set down all dreams. We can set down all impermanence. Not try to make this our permanent home. Not at all. So, here we are at the crossroads, the crackdown time, and also the time of blessing. You can get a sense of this blessing, even though you still have some intrigue. Even though you still have some intrigue, you're entitled to it. You're entitled to it. You're entitled to know your options. That doesn't mean that you are going to accept it. You may still follow your intrigue about the ego secret, but in the back of your mind, you know you've got options. You know you've got options, and that's a big, big, big thing. That's a big deal. Huge, huge, huge. You might say to the matriarchal goddess that they're going to put on the throne, you may say, I've got options. I've got options. I don't think I'm going to get into that. I've got options. So that's a big deal. It's a big deal. You have options. All right. So I do have to get about the day here. But it's been great sharing this with you. And remember, you have options. Be aware that you have the right to at least get a sense of the blessing, you know. At least get a sense of it. You do have that right. You have the right to know that you have options. All right, here we go.